topic of risk, I was wondering how these large hedge funds and their ability to take on large amounts of risk and leverage themselves, how that affects the market.
Well, hedge funds are investment companies that are not approved for the general retail market. So they're not allowed to advertise. They're not well known because they're not allowed to promote themselves except through private conversations. And to invest in them, you have to be an accredited investor, not a general investor. So they are allowed to do sophisticated and dangerous things. The idea is a hedge fund is regulated for people who have professional advisors or family offices. You know what a family office is? If you are really rich, you don't just hire an advisor. You get a team of advisors who, that's their whole job, is to work on your family investments. That's what hedge funds are really for. So they're dangerous because they're not, you know, it's like taking drugs. You need a physician to between you and the drugs. Often in the past, hedge funds have done really well. In recent years, they haven't been doing well, on average, for the most of them. I don't know that I recommend them. I can't recommend them as a group. But if you're, do you have a family office? I assume you don't.
I do not.
If your family office recommends it, go for it. But if you've selected them carefully. But they just represent the most, claiming to be the most sophisticated investors. And another notable thing about hedge funds is that traditionally they pay very high rewards to their investment managers if they outperform. But that comes out of your pocket. And there are skeptics of hedge funds saying, I would never pay those high management, those expenses to the people who invest my money, because nobody can deserve that amount. And so hedge funds, in a sense, are, at least many of them are, have been a bubble in themselves. They were doing well for a while. The impression was they were doing well. Lots of people piled into them. And lately, they haven't been doing so well.
I guess related, like, these big financial institutions can take on a lot of risk, and this risk that they take on has the potential to cause massive financial crises. Should there be a way to, like, regulate this risk, or how much of this risk should be regulated versus how much is it important to the inherent way that these institutions are run?
Yeah, well, I think that we are in a situation where we've had heightened recognition of the importance of regulating for dealing with big risks, that systemic risks. So a systemic risk is a risk that the whole system will collapse, like a house of cards, some people say. Regulation before 2008-2009 crisis was mostly microprudential. That means they wanted to make sure that you as an investor weren't being ripped off by this stockbroker who was squirreling away your money or doing something like that. They were thinking of you as an individual. But we've now had new impetus for macroprudential regulation. And it's now regulation about how interconnected are you with other, are some big business connected? And what will happen if that other business fails to this business? So we want to, or if there's a world financial crisis, how will this business fare? So since the 2008-2009 financial crisis, we've seen a lot more macroprudential regulation and a lot more measures of risk that are being developed. There are now what we call stress tests of financial institutions that emphasize more their interconnectedness and how they would act in, how they would fare in various kinds of international crises.
What are some measures of risk, I guess, post-2008 crisis now that are more appropriate to measuring?
Well, yeah, well, that's a controversy. Before the crisis, there was regulation. It's not new. And there was some concern with macroprudential. For example, before the crisis, there was a method called value at risk that was used to measure the risk of a company by looking at the assets and liabilities of the company and considering what the probability of big correction in the values would be and what it would mean for the company. But after the financial crisis, we now have more elaborate assessments of macro risk. And the stress test will consider what the government regulator will specify that the financial institution should estimate how it would be affected by various kinds of financial crises. So it's getting more detailed and more effort is being put into it. That's because the 2008 crisis caught us all off guard. And people just didn't know how interconnected banks and other financial institutions were. And they had to act in ignorance as a guess because too much of their data collection was microprudential.
I have one more question.
Yeah.
It's about going back to the idea of measuring risks. So in class you mentioned Nassim Taleb's idea of the black swans, right? And he said that all these models to measure risk are, if you read his book, are fundamentally flawed because they don't take into account these super improbable events like a black swan.
Right, right.
In a way, you could say that the financial crisis in 2007 was one of those events. So do you think there's ways to improve these models to take into account more unlikely events like these black swans? Or
yeah.
The method is fundamentally flawed to take into account.
Right. So you're referring to Nassim Taleb, who had a book called The Black Swan that talked about rare, low-probability events as being sometimes really big.
Yeah.
So you could work a lifetime creating creating wealth under certain assumptions that something can't happen. Mm. And then, bang, you've lost everything for your whole lifetime because you thought it couldn't happen. That's kind of what happened in the recent crisis. People thought that home prices can never fall because they never have, or they never have since the Great Depression. And so, I know that's a perfect example, but this is hard to deal with academically. If you're talking about rare, big events, well, you don't have enough data on them because they're rare. So it's a problem. Things that happen in the market, this is what efficient markets people sometimes say, that the markets have to deal with the probability of these rare big events. But they're so intangible and they're just something that I can't quantify. But when the market goes down, Eugene Fama might say, when the market goes down, don't just assume it's crazy. Maybe it is some subtle evidence about some big event that could happen. So I got to give it, that is a possible interpretation. We just never know. I wish there weren't these big black swan events. Finance would be so much better a profession to be in. Unfortunately, we live in a real world. I shouldn't put it like that. We live in a world with the risk of huge events.
So, like, we have so many risks in our life, like as we said, if you go into a labor market during a recession, or basically if something bad happens, like, you need to find a way to hedge it. Yeah. We have stuff for, like, hedging against oil risk, for agricultural risk. Are there any innovative financial products for hedging against, say, labor market risks?
Well, I'm glad you asked that question, because this has been a theme of mine for a long time, that we should have labor market risk. Now, we do have something. Unemployment insurance was started in the United Kingdom, I think it was 1911. The idea is temporary assistance for finding a good job. Now, they realized there in the UK that people often are desperate when they lose their job. They have a family, and often people have no savings. So what the person does is takes what has to, right? Take the first job offer, and it's often not a very good career track for them. And so it's hard for them to move to another job. So let's give them time. Let's give them maybe 6 months of support so that they can find the right job. And also give them some kind of help in finding a job. They'll have a career service for them. That's an old idea. The question is whether we can do more. The unemployment insurance is really focused on finding a job in the short run. But now there's a problem that we're seeing inequality grow in many places around the world. And we see a lot of people who are complaining differently, that often it occurs when they're middle-aged. Say they're 50 years old and they lose their job. They suddenly find themselves they can get some job, so unemployment, but they can only get those bad jobs because somehow people want to hire young people, and they'd have to be retrained, and someone doesn't want to retrain them because they might not stay as long, and so they have a problem. So the one idea, I call it livelihood insurance. This is kind of a futuristic idea, but it's not just, there was Laurie Kletzer, and Robert Lighton, another couple of economists, wrote a paper about 15 years ago for the similar idea. They called it wage insurance. So the idea is when somebody loses their job and has to take a job at a lower wage, they should be able to collect on an insurance policy. Interestingly, President Obama brought this idea up during his State of the Union address for 2016. So the President of the United States appears behind this idea. Unfortunately, a lot of ideas that President Obama has been behind don't happen. Yeah. So, but the other thought of it, he was proposing to be some government insurance. I don't see why it has to be exclusively government. There could be private insurers or private markets that would help protect people against loss of income. But I think it's actually very important now, more so than in the past, because of the rapid increase in information technology and robotics and the rapid globalization. So things can happen really fast that make one's investment in human capital obsolete. And absolutely, there should be risk management devices for that. And the important thing, as I've argued in my books, is if you help people manage risk, they will take more risks. That's what we want. We want people in their decisions about their education to do some risk taking, develop some specialty that is at risk of being obsolete. But who knows? Nobody knows. You're taking a chance. Let's encourage people to take chances.